Well, hey guys, welcome to Hope City. My name is Justin, I'm one of the pastors here at Hope City. I'm so glad that you're here. If you are a guest with us today, we're so pumped that you would decide to spend part of your Sunday with us. I know you could be a lot of different places today, and we're just honored that you would be with us today. I am really bummed that I am not here, but I'm actually really excited that I'm not here as well. Let me explain. When we moved here 2 years ago to start Hope City, we knew that Indianapolis didn't need just another church. It needed a movement of churches across the city to reach the 1.4 million people who are far from God. And when I met Josh Huseman at Mercy Road, he and I really aligned with that belief that we want to be a part of something much bigger than just a local church. We want to be a part of a movement. And so last year, we started an organization, a nonprofit, 501c3, called Multiply Indiana, with a goal of planting 20 churches in the next 20 years. What you may not know is you guys have already helped plant one church this year called City of Lights Church in Broad Ripple. And John Owens is a senior pastor there, and they're doing a phenomenal job reaching their community. Well, this fall, you get the opportunity to be a part of another church plant called Echo Church in Avon, Indiana. And so this morning, I am not here speaking because I am actually at Mercy Road speaking this morning, like 1.4 miles from here. And I've invited my friend Chad Lunsford, who is the senior pastor of Echo Church, to speak to us today. So he's going to share a little bit about his story, his journey, why Echo Church, and how we can help impact the city of Avon. And here's what you may not know. Over the last 12 months, we've been able, through Multiply Indiana, to raise and give away over $150,000 to plant new churches, not just here in Indianapolis, but in southern Indiana. And we plan to continue to do that until we reach the 1.4 million people that live in this city and that we can be a part of a movement. And so I want you to do me a favor. Last weekend, Trish and I were speaking in a church in Wisconsin, and they did an unbelievable job of welcoming us to the stage. It like blew me away. And so I don't want to be outdone by people in Wisconsin. So would you please give a warm Hope City welcome to my friend, Chad Lunsford.
Well, good morning, Hope City, and welcome. It's an honor to be here. As Hoosiers, we will never be outdone by Wisconsin people, right? Like, that is not okay. It's not acceptable. So thank you for the warm welcome. I tell you, it's truly an honor to be here. I'm excited to be here. I'll admit it's a bit intimidating. Justin and Trish are incredible communicators, so I'm honored to be up here. I'm a little intimidated. I'm a little intimidated because Justin's like 7 feet tall, too, and I'm decidedly not that big. I mean, he's just a really tall guy. And I actually have to follow him 2 weeks in a row. I'm going to be at Mercy Road next week. So, hey, here as I start, I want to really give some of my time to just kind of giving honor where honor is due. And you may or may not know this. I don't know where you're at and you're part of the story of Hope City, but planting a church is one of the hardest things to do, in my opinion, on the planet. And it's not just because we're living it out right now, but especially in the church world, it's one of the hardest things to do. And so for Justin and Trish to leave so much behind and to trust God and to step out in faith and to sacrifice so much, man, they just deserve so much honor. But not only them, so many of you who are serving, you get up early, you've been a part of the infancy of Hope City. And just as we start, I know you've already clapped once. Can we just give honor and thanks and appreciation for all the people that have made Hope City possible, and especially to Justin and Trish. I tell you, it's a hard thing to do. So we are, as Echo Church, we are a part of the Multiply Indiana Network. We are honored to be a part of it. We're excited to be a part of it. We're excited to see what God's going to do, as Justin was saying, across the city of Indianapolis and beyond that, across the state of Indiana. So my wife and I, we grew up on the west side of the state in Brazil, Indiana. If you've never been to Brazil, you may have been there, you just didn't know it. You might have just been passing by an I-70. You had no idea that you were in Brazil, Indiana. So we grew up kind of out in the sticks on the west side of the state. Echo Church is going to be on the west side of Indianapolis in the Avon community, and we're super excited to be there. For the last 10 years, my wife and I have been all over the country. We've been in Los Angeles, the Durham, North Carolina, so kind of from coast to coast. And then most recently, we were kind of in between. We were in Jackson, Mississippi, and we believe that God was calling us back home, specifically to the Indianapolis area, to start a life-giving church called Echo Church. And so we landed here back in March, and we had our first event back in April. So just the Saturday right before Easter, we had an Easter egg hunt just to bless the community as our first sort of act in the community, let people know that we exist and that we're there. And we were hoping that maybe 200 or 300 people would show up. We thought, man, if that happened, that would be a really good day, and a lot of people would find out about us. As we were starting to look at registration the day before, We might actually have somewhere around 500 people, and we were starting to freak out because we were kind of big, borrowing and stealing volunteers from anywhere that we possibly could. And then the day of, 1,000 people showed up, and we were just completely blown away, and we're excited to see all that God has in store. For us, that was just an indicator that, there's something needed here in the community, and so we're excited to be there. And since then, we've been building our team. We've got about 35 people that are on our team right now. Tonight, we've got our final vision night just to kind of let people know what we're about before we start really building the team and getting ready to launch on September 10th. So if you know anybody in Hendricks County, they're on the west side of the city, please point them in our direction. So, hey, so we're excited to be here. And here's what I want to talk about this morning as we get rolling. I want to talk about this theme of this, uncertainty and assurance. Uncertainty and assurance. I know those words kind of seem juxtaposed, but I found in my life of late that they're actually quite connected. Uncertainty and assurance. As I was praying about and thinking about what I wanted to share today, I really feel like God was leading me to just kind of share where our family has been over the past few months. I mentioned to you that that God has obviously blessed our efforts. God's doing great things, but there's been challenges along the way as well. And so what I want to do today is help you, if you find yourself in a tough season right now, I kind of want to give you a guidebook for what do you do if you're in a tough season. Specifically, I want to answer this question. What do you do when life is uncertain? What do you do when life is uncertain? I mentioned just a moment ago that we had 1,000 people that showed up to our first event. And so that Saturday, we were high-fiving and cheering. It was just a really great event. As you can imagine, we've been praying and preparing for that moment for a long time and moreover for the launch that's coming. So we were super excited. But it might give a little bit more texture to what was actually happening inside of us if you knew what happened the day before. On Friday, so this was Good Friday night, about 6 o'clock, we received a phone call completely out of the blue that my wife, Katie, that her grandfather had suddenly and unexpectedly passed away. And so somewhere around midnight, we were over in Brazil, about an hour away from Avon, spending time just grieving with family. So we were there kind of in the middle of the night and then rushed back over, and then 1,000 people showed up. And so we were celebrating, but there was also just deep mourning that was taking place inside of us as well. Just days before, we had celebrated together as a family his 80th birthday party. You know, we've been gone for 10 years, and so we were not only excited to be coming back to our home state to do kingdom work, but selfishly just to be close to family. But it hasn't exactly panned out as we had planned. There was a patriarch in our family that was just gone in a moment with really out any notice. A month ago, I got a phone call in the middle of the night about 1:30 a.m. How many of you know when you get a phone call at 1:30 in the a.m., right? There's this sort of sinking feeling in your stomach. It's not a good moment. It's either somebody that got a hold of you incorrectly, or it's the other. And so we got this bad news, right? And at 1:30 a.m., I answered the phone. It was my sister calling me to let me know that my mom was rushing my dad to the hospital. They kind of live out in the middle of nowhere, and they were driving to hospital in Terre Haute. And my dad woke up and he couldn't feel the entire right side of his body. And so my mom was rushing him to the hospital, and come to find out that he had had a stroke. And I just want to say, you know, over the last sort of 90 days, or, you know, even more so than that, 4 months, it's just been this incredible roller coaster. While we're sort of stepping out into this great adventure of planting a church, as you can imagine, there's been this deep sorrow and there's been this kind of fear of the unknown. It's all sort of led up to this great uncertainty. But here's what I want to share this morning. In the midst of great uncertainty, there's actually been a greater assurance of God's faithfulness more than ever. In the midst of this great uncertainty, we have never been more sure of God's faithfulness. And that's what I want to share with you today, what that looks like. You see, even in the midst of great uncertainty, God's faithfulness can be seen. In fact, if you find yourself in a difficult season today, would you just hear this? The presence of a storm does not equal God's absence. The presence of a storm does not equal God's absence. In fact, the presence of a storm is often the preparation for God to bring about some kind of growth in your life. You don't always see it that way when you're in the storm, but if you will just lean into God, a storm's presence is often that precursor to God displaying his power in you in a new way. Maybe you're in a difficult season right now. Maybe there's a job situation that's going on, and you didn't ask for it, you didn't want it, but God has just sort of brought it onto your lap. Or maybe it wasn't even God at all, it's just things that have come about. Maybe there's a health scare for you as well that's come into your life and you don't know what to do or where to turn and the prognosis isn't all that great. Maybe there's a relational struggle for you, or maybe there's not a relationship at all and you're asking God, when is Mr. Wright or Mrs. Wright going to come along? And there's just uncertainty. There's this fear of the future. Perhaps for you today, you're asking the question, what do I do when life is uncertain? There's a moment, a passage in Matthew chapter 8. I want us to look at it. If you have your Bible, you're welcome to turn there. We'll have it on the screen as well in just a moment. In Matthew chapter 8, there's this moment for the disciples, and even more than just great uncertainty. In fact, they're pretty certain their lives are about to end in a moment. And I think if we look closely at this passage, it kind of gives us this blueprint for what do you do when life is uncertain. If you would you read it along with me. In Matthew chapter 8, we're going to start at verse 18. In verse 18, it says this, when Jesus saw the crowd around him, he gave the orders to cross to the other side of the lake. He's talking to the disciples. I'm going to skip ahead to verse 23. Then he got into the boat and his disciples followed him. Suddenly, a furious storm came up on the lake so that the waves swept over the boat. I want to stop there for just a moment. The first two verses, we see something really important. Now, you got to see this, right? Who was the one who told them to get into the boat? It was Jesus. Who was the first one to get into the boat? Jesus, right? The disciples, they're just following what Jesus said to do. And yet what happens? Right? There's this storm that comes upon them. Everything we're about to see that's coming, this is Jesus' fault, right? Like he's the one who told them to get into the boat. The waves were sweeping over the boat, and then it says this, in great juxtaposition, but Jesus was sleeping. Can you picture, right? The waves are crashing because there's just this furious storm that's come up, and Jesus is just sleeping in the boat. The disciples went and woke him, saying, Lord, save us, we're going to drown. He replied, you of little faith, why are you so afraid? Then he got up and he rebuked the winds and the waves, and it was completely calm. The men were amazed and asked, what kind of man is this that even the winds and the waves obey him? It's an incredible story, one perhaps you're familiar with. But I want to look at it specifically through that lens of what do you do when life is uncertain? Jesus is the one who tells them to get into the boat. They get into the boat. There's this furious storm. They're certain they are about to drown. And then Jesus comes in and he speaks peace into the midst of this storm in their lives. So what do you do? What do you do when life is uncertain? Here's the first thing I think this shows us. It's this. If you're taking notes, stay close to Jesus. Stay close to Jesus. Now, I think that might be the thing you would say, well, that's obvious, right? Of course. Yeah, well, it seems that way when you're looking at a Bible story. But in my experience, when storms hit our lives, we often run from God instead of running to him. Right? Maybe you've seen that. Maybe you've seen it in your own life or in the lives of others. You'll be tempted to jump out of the boat because the boat's filling with water, right? But if Jesus is in the boat, like you stay in the boat. If you're in a tough relationship right now, you're not sure what to do, I just wanted you to hear this morning, would you stay close to Jesus? If you're in a difficult situation at work and nobody would even know if you were just sort of to compromise on your morals, would you just stay close to Jesus? If you're fearful of something that hasn't yet happened, there's not even a guarantee that it's going to happen, there's just this anxiety that's just welling up in you, would you just stay close to Jesus regardless of the circumstance or the storm that you're facing? So the question you should be asking right now is, well, how? How do I stay close to Jesus? Let me give you four quick things. The first one is this, would you worship him? Would you worship him? Now, it's sort of funny if you think about it. If you picture the disciples, right, in the midst of a storm, why would they want to worship, right? They're just trying to stay alive. But I would say in our own lives, when we encounter a storm, encounter uncertainty, even if you don't feel like it, even if the circumstances around you don't really lend you to a worshipful moment, would you just worship him? 2 Chronicles 16:9, it says this, the eyes of the Lord search the whole earth. Why? In order to strengthen those whose hearts are fully committed to him. Can you picture God? He's scanning the earth. And he wants to. It's his desire to come and to strengthen his children. It's what God wants to do. Well, who's he going to strengthen? Those whose hearts are fully committed on him. God is scanning. He's looking for people who are just sold out to him regardless of the circumstance. Why? So he can come alongside of them and strengthen them. God is drawn to worship. It's magnetic to him. He can't help but come alongside of you when your heart is fully committed to him. When I got the phone call that my dad was in the hospital, and I got up and kind of had the 80-minute drive from Avon over to Terre Haute, it was middle of the night, right? I'm on I-70 going, and there's nothing to look at. There's nothing to see. It's just pitch black on I-70. So for 80 minutes straight, I got out my phone, I got on Spotify, and I just worshiped. I just worshiped God because I wanted my eyes to focus on him and I wanted to lift up his name above the situation, regardless of what I was going to walk into there at the hospital and we didn't know yet. I just wanted my eyes to be fixed on Jesus. If you find yourself in the storm, would you first worship him? The second thing is this, would you dive into scripture? Would you dive into scripture? Proverbs 4:20 says this, my child, Pay attention to what I say. Listen carefully to my words. Don't lose sight of them. In fact, let them penetrate deep into your heart, for they bring life to those who find them and healing to their whole body. Maybe you would say today, I'm in need of that. Like, I'm in need of God kind of coming in and bringing life to my soul. I just sort of feel dead inside right now. If that's you, would you dive into his words? The second day that I drove, so went with the first day, just worshiped the whole way to the hospital, wasn't sure what I was going to encounter. The second day, I drove over the 80 minutes to see my dad and kind of see where things were at that day. I just listened to scripture the whole time. I got out the Bible app. I'm not kidding. I just listened to scripture the whole way over because I wanted to speak and hear the truth of God's word over whatever I was going to encounter there at the hospital, right? Like, regardless of whatever the doctors were saying, I know God's above all of it. So I just wanted to be focused on God's word. If life is uncertain for you, would you focus on his word? The next thing is this: would you pray like your life depends on it? Would you pray like your life depends on it? Because here's the thing, it does. Like, God uses these difficult seasons as benchmarks in our life. God wants to move, right? Like, there's never a hurt that's wasted in God. Whatever's going on in your life, if you'll lean into him, he will take that season and actually turn it into good. Would you pray like your life depends on it? The psalmist says this in Psalm 107, "Lord, help," they cried in their trouble, "and he saved them from their distress. He calmed the storm to a whisper and stilled the waves." The psalmist is writing this centuries before this encounter with the disciples. He calms it and stilled the waves. What a blessing was that stillness as he brought them safely into harbor. Would you pray like your life depends on it? When the doctors and nurses would come into the room, I can specifically remember there was this one time that we were all just kind of downcast. The news that we had just gotten from one of the doctors was, it was the moment we were waiting to kind of hear the prognosis, but we didn't hear what we wanted to hear. And we kind of learned that my dad, the right side of his body, he may never fully recover feeling on that side of his body. Now, he's actually doing quite well considering the stroke and what, like, the stroke happened in the brainstem. So it was a very strategic place to hit. He's doing quite well. But I remember we kind of gathered ourselves. There were some people who just stopped by to see my dad. And as a family, we just kind of walked out. And we just reminded each other, regardless of what the doctors are saying right now, now we know how to pray, right? Like whatever's going to happen, God is above all of it. God can move. He can do whatever God wants to do. And I remember at that moment, I believe if I remember correctly, that was on day two, the doctor kind of came in and gave that word to us. And I was driving over on day four of my dad being in the hospital. My mom called me. She said, you know, the physical therapist and the doctors, they've been talking about your dad staying here for another 2 weeks just to do physical and occupational therapy. But an administrator just came in and said your dad's doing far too well, that they're actually kicking him out of the hospital today. He's just doing so great. And to this moment, like, my dad's walking. And if you were to see him today, you would have no idea that he had a stroke. Now, there was a new normal for him. But you would never know it. And I just believe it's from worship and through prayer, through living, you know, for just sitting on the scriptures, that God's just done this powerful work in his life. But here's the other thing I want you to know. If you're in the midst of a difficult season, not only that, but would you find Jesus seeking friends? Right? The first three might seem like, yeah, I expected a pastor to say that. But would you find Jesus seeking friends? I know that small groups are a huge part, a foundation of what Hope City is all about. And if you find yourself in a difficult season, you need people around you who are building you up. The writer of Proverbs says this: walk with the wise and become wise, but if you associate with fools, you get into troubles. Walk with the wise and you become wise. Whoever's around you in those moments, right, they're either going to build you up or they're going to be with you and kind of tearing you down. You don't need people helping you, right, tearing you down when you're in those difficult situations. You need people that are pointing your eyes to Jesus. I remember we had literally hundreds of people, I'm not exaggerating when I say that, hundreds of people coming alongside of us and praying for my dad in that situation. We were seeking someone who would kind of help us and know what next steps to take, right? When someone in your family's hurting, like, you want the best to be helping you in that moment. My dad was in Terre Haute. We wanted to get him to Indianapolis to see a specialist. And so we just began praying like crazy. We began, you know, contacting every contact that we have here in the city. We're brand new, right, to the Indianapolis area. And we come to find out that there's 4 stroke care specialists in the entire city. I don't know if that's disconcerting to you. It was a little disconcerting to me. With 2 million people, there's 4 stroke specialists in the entire city of Indianapolis, maybe 10 in the entire state. Things you learn, right, in crisis moments. And we got to talk to two of those specialists here in Indianapolis. I don't know how you find those two people in the midst of 2 million people, but God helped us to find them. One of them talked to me on the phone for about 60 minutes one day. She actually works at the VA hospital, so she referred my dad to somebody that she actually developed and mentored, who's probably one of the best stroke care specialists in the state. And he sat with us for 2 hours as a family one day, just helping us know our next steps. How did that come about? We had people around us who were praying for us. We had people around us who are lifting us up. If you find yourself in a difficult circumstance, would you just stay close to Jesus? Right? You might feel like running away, like the boat's filling up with water, and I gotta get out, but would you just stay close to Jesus? Here's the second thing. Would you hold on to what you know to be true? Hold on to what you know to be true. I want to look back at verse 25 of Matthew 8 for just a second. It says this, and they came to him and they woke him, saying, "Save us, Lord, we are perishing." And he said to them, "Why are you afraid, you men of little faith?" Now, I don't know about you, but this may seem like a harsh statement, right? Some of these guys are fishermen, and if they're afraid of the storm that's come up, they've seen a few storms in their life, and if they're afraid, they're convinced they're going to drown. Like maybe it's a bad storm, right? So why does Jesus step into it and say, "You men of little faith"? I think we need to know a little bit more of the context of what's going on. In this chapter alone, the disciples have seen Jesus do incredible miracles. If you go back to the beginning of this chapter, they see Jesus heal a man who had leprosy. In a moment, he was full of disease all over his body, and in a moment, it just washed away. The disciples, they saw this with their own eyes. In a moment, they saw there was a Roman soldier who came to Jesus, and he said, "My son is in a different town, but I'm not worthy of you to come to my town. Would you just speak it now and heal him?" Even in a different city. Right? Jesus wasn't in the room. He wasn't in the same house. He wasn't even in the same city, and Jesus spoke a word, and that little boy, they come to find out later, was healed at that very moment. They saw this happen. Before they get into the boat, right before they get into the boat, it says that Jesus was up on a hillside, and they were bringing people who were demon-possessed, they were bringing people who were in need of healing physically, and it says that Jesus healed every single person that was brought to him. The disciples saw this, right? And yet, in the middle of the storm, their faith is waning. Why? Mark chapter 4, and the exact same story is told to us by Mark. And he gives us, I think, a little bit more texture, a little bit more color to what's happening in this. I want to look at it for just a second from Mark's vantage point. Mark says this in verse 37 of chapter 4. "And there arose a fierce gale of wind, and the waves were breaking over the boat, so much that the boat was already filling up. Jesus himself was in the stern, asleep on the cushion." Right? You can picture it. Jesus, he's just chilling. I mean, he's comfortable on the cushion. "And they woke him and said to him," catch this, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?" See, now I think we're getting somewhere. Matthew didn't give us those lines. "Do you not care that we are perishing?" See, they've seen Jesus do incredible miracles for other people. They've seen Jesus do great things for other people. They've seen Jesus be good for other people. So I don't think that they're questioning whether or not Jesus can do something great. I think what they're questioning is whether or not Jesus wants to do something great for them. And I wonder if you've ever had that moment, right? Yeah, I know God does great things. I know God's a good person. He does good things for other people, but will he actually do good and great things for me? And I think that's sometimes an internal struggle for us. And I think we get it, right? When the wind is blowing in life, when the waters are crashing in, it's just disorienting. And in this moment, little by little, we begin to forget all the things that God's already taught us. And I think that's what Jesus is saying. "You men of little faith, have you not seen me do all these things? You've been right there beside me. You know how I feel about you. And yet in this moment, how could you even say, do you not care?" Of course, Jesus said, of course I care about you. Right? I've brought you alongside of me, right, to take this movement on after I am gone. Of course I care about you. See, Jesus expects more of them because they've already had these victories in their lives. And here's what happens. So often when God does something in our lives, we leave it in the past. We don't bring it into our present struggles. And what Jesus is telling them, and he's telling us, is whenever you have a victory from the past, you need to bring it into your present. It always informs what God's bringing you into today. I wonder for you, maybe in the past or maybe even right now, has there been a time for you when God seemed uncaring? And if you're being honest, maybe you wouldn't say it out loud if you were sitting in a group of people, but if you were being honest, you'd say, yeah, there was a time when it felt like God was uncaring. At least God, maybe it felt like he was uncooperative, or maybe it felt like God was late, right? If we were raise our hands in here, I think everybody would raise their hand. Yeah, I've had one of those moments. Maybe work wasn't going the way that you want. Maybe your kids are going through something, and as a parent, you desperately want to fix it for them, but you can't fix it. Maybe you're worried about your future. Maybe it's a financial challenge, and you don't see any way conceivable for this thing to come about. Maybe there's a health issue, like in my own family, and you just want it to be fixed, and you're so thoroughly exhausted by what you've been going through. Was there a time when you felt like God was late? And if that was happening, my guess is you began to forget the things that God had already taught you. Now we know what the disciples are going through. And Jesus looks at him and says, you have little faith, right? Everything you already know to be true, bring it into this current season. If you're going through a difficult season right now, there's two things I want you just to hold on to, all right? The first thing is this. Would you just say to yourself, even right now, God loves me. God loves me. Right? Regardless of how you feel, regardless of what you see around you, would you just say to yourself right now, God loves me. The writer in Lamentations says this, yet this I call to mind and therefore I have hope. Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed, for his compassions, they never fail. Maybe you just need to be reminded of that today, that he never fails. And whatever you're going through today, I promise you, he will not fail you either. They are new every morning, great is your faithfulness. Would you just repeat to yourself in this moment, in this week, God loves me. Doesn't matter what I feel, doesn't even matter what I see around me, I can know that God loves me. Second thing is this, God wants the best for me. God wants the best for me, right? So just like the disciples, we know you do great things for other people, Jesus, but what about us? Would you just know God wants the best for you as well? Not just the person next to you, for you. Paul says this in Romans chapter 8. If God is for us, who can ever be against us? Since he did not spare even his own son, but gave him up for us all, right? We just need to be reminded of that sometimes. We know it. It's at the core of the gospel, right? But God gave up his son for you. Like, I love you guys. I don't know if I do that. I kind of like my son. But Jesus, or God loved us so much, he gave up Jesus on our behalf. Won't he also give us everything else? Does it mean he no longer loves us if we have trouble or calamity? That's what we think, right? If there's things going on in our lives, we start to think, well, maybe God doesn't like me, or maybe God's mad at me. Does it mean he no longer loves us if we have trouble or calamity, or are persecuted or hungry or destitute or in danger or threatened with death? No. Despite all these things, overwhelming victory is ours through Christ who loved us. If you're going through a storm today, would you just be reminded that God loves you and that God wants the best for you? Right? Everything you've already learned about God, would you bring it into this present situation and be reminded that you are loved? See, when we see Jesus on the cross, that is our once and for all reminder forever that God loves us and he's made a way. It may not feel like it in the moment, right? You want this season, you want this storm to pass, but would you just be reminded that he loves you and he wants the best for you? Third and final thing is this, that we can learn from this story. Would you invite God to redeem your circumstances? Would you invite God to redeem your circumstances regardless of what's going on in your life, whether it's something that you did and it's kind of bringing these consequences in, or if you're like the disciples and he's kind of put you into this boat and it's, you know, gone into this storm, regardless of the circumstances, God can redeem them. Maybe you just need to be reminded of that today. Whatever you're going through, God can redeem them. There's no hurt, there's no pain, there's no struggle. There is no season that's wasted in God. If you will turn to him in the middle of it, he can redeem any situation. But, catch this, but if we're living overwhelmed, if we're living bitter, afraid, angry, frustrated, we're not allowing God to move in those circumstances. Right? See, our attitude in the middle of those circumstances dictates much of what we learn in the process. If you're living overwhelmed and bitter and frustrated, you don't allow God to work. But I wonder, did you see what the disciples learned in Matthew 8? Did you catch what they say? Let's go back to it one last time. Matthew 8, verse 25, the disciples went and woke him saying, Lord, save us, we're going to drown. He replied, you have little faith. Why are you so afraid? Then he got up and he rebuked the winds and the waves and it was completely calm. The men were amazed and they asked, what kind of man is this? Even the winds and the waves obey him. It's a great question, isn't it? What kind of man is this? Even the winds and the waves obey him. See, they didn't know that yet. This is early in the gospel story. They don't know that he's the Son of God. They don't know that the winds and the waves have to obey his authority. They don't know that he's the one who created the molecules that make up the water, that make up the sand, that make up the sea, you know, sea bottom. They don't know who this Jesus is. Who is this man that even the winds and the waves obey him. See, Jesus knows the challenges that they're about to face. Right? When he ascends to heaven, they know what's coming. He knows what's coming for them. Our religious officials, government officials are going to persecute them. They're going to be scattered across the known world. Friends and family are going to be persecuted and even murdered. Jesus knows what's coming for them, and he knows that he needs to teach them that when a storm comes up, you don't run in fear, but you can actually trust me in the process. You can trust me to be good and great even in your life. And it might not always work out like we want it to, but God knows what's best for us, and he's bringing about the best for you regardless of the situation. All right, they can either see every storm as an opportunity or as this great inducer of fear, but it all depends on your attitude in the process. The Apostle Paul, right, just a couple decades later, he's going to be shipwrecked. And it could be this moment where he looks and says, God's about to do something great, or has my God left me? He no longer loves me. He's gone a different direction. Let me play a quick what-if game. What if Jesus never tells the disciples to get into the boat? What if Jesus sees the storm coming, he calms it before the disciples even look? You know, maybe they were looking one direction and Jesus sees it coming and he just calms it. So they never even encounter the storm. They never get to see him as the one that even the winds and the waves obey him. Jesus is teaching them something about himself and about who they are in him. They're going to have that kind of authority. What if the disciples, when the waves are crashing and the boat's filling up and it's sinking, they jump ship, they never even go to Jesus. They just try to figure it out on their own. They never actually learn what it means when you lean on Jesus, how he can speak peace into the storm. I wonder, what about us? What about you? What if you were to fully lean into Jesus in this tough season and trust him? What would he bring about in your life? Maybe you'd come to a place and say, who is this man? That he even moves in my business ventures. I didn't know that God could do that. Who is this man that can restore a relationship that seemed all but gone, all but dead, but Jesus can step in and heal it? Who is this man that can even move in educational environments or health situations? Who is this man? I didn't know that he could do this. God is wanting to do something in you in this very moment. I'm reminded of the story of Job. If you're not familiar with Job, he was a man who was greatly blessed. It's actually the oldest story in all of Scripture. Job was greatly blessed, and it says that Satan comes and he attacks Job, and he does so in such a way really to persecute him. And Job takes away every good thing he has in his life. He kills his children, he kills his livestock, he takes away all of his business. He even has like disease on his body. I mean, he's at the bottom of it. In time, God comes and redeems all of it and actually gives him beyond what he even started with. And Job comes to this place in the midst of this story of saying, my ear had heard of you, God, but now my eye sees you. I love that. Maybe for you, you've had situations where you've seen God move in great ways in other people's lives, and you say, God, I've heard of you, but God, I want to see you move even in my life. Would you invite God to redeem your circumstances even right now? Paul says it this way in Romans 8, and we know that God causes everything, not some things, God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to his purpose for them. When you lean into God, you invite him to take everything, regardless of what it is, and to turn it into your good, to turn it into your good. See, when we see with eyes of faith, you can weather any storm and know for certain that God has a plan for me and God will bring me through. Regardless of what's going on, regardless of what it feels like right now, you can have that kind of faith and assurance. Right? That even in the midst of great uncertainty, you can be sure of God's faithfulness in the process. A storm's presence does not equal God's absence. In fact, the presence of a storm is often the preparation or a precursor to God wanting to do something great in your life. So if you'll lean into him in the midst of that storm, you're inviting him to display his power in you in ways you never even thought possible. If you're in a season of uncertainty today, would you stay close to Jesus? Would you hold on to what you know to be true? Would you invite God to redeem your circumstances? Here's what I know to be true. If you will lean into him, what you're going through today will someday be a story you get to tell somebody else of the way that God came in and encouraged you and built you up. That's what God wants to do in you. He wants to redeem whatever you're going through so you can use it to encourage somebody else. Would you pray with me? As we turn our hearts to God in prayer, I want to pray for two people specifically, two groups of people. If you're here today and you're in this season of uncertainty, you would say, I'm in the midst of a storm in my own life. Would you just tell God right now, God, that's me. God, I feel like the disciples in that boat, things are overcoming me. They're overwhelming me. God, I feel like I'm drowning. I feel like I can't breathe. God, there's just great uncertainty all around me. Would you just say to God, God, that's me. And if you haven't been running to him, would you just say right now, God, I'm sorry. I got disoriented, took my eyes off of you. But in this moment, God, I'm turning back to you. And I'm trusting you. I'm trusting that you love me, that you want the best for me, that you have a plan for me, that you're going to bring me through. Would you hear God just saying he loves you? Would you just hear God saying, if you'll just lift your eyes to me, I'll lift you up. I'll come alongside of you and encourage you. If you'll just hear my words in my scripture, I'll encourage you day in and day out. If you'll just pray to me, I'll swoop in quick. If you'll invite other people around you, they're going to point your eyes to me. You can live in this place of rest just like Jesus in the boat. Would you hear God encouraging you today? That he's with you and he's never leaving you and he has never left you. There's a second group of people I want to pray for today. If you're here today and you say, I've never surrendered my life to Christ. I've been doing everything my way and I don't even know where to begin, but I know that I need Jesus in my life. If that's you today, would you just simply pray this? Would you just say, God, I'm sorry I've been going my own way. But today I want to go your way. I feel you moving in this room, in this moment, and I want to surrender my life to you. I realize I'm a sinner in need of a Savior, and I believe that Jesus is that Savior, and I want to follow him with my whole life. I believe that he died on the cross for my sins. He rose up from the dead to give me new life, and I want to follow him with everything. God, for all of us today, Lord, we look to you. God, in this moment where we lift our voices and moreover that we lift our hearts to you in worship, God, we know that you are great. Lord, we know that you are good. And it's not just in other people's lives, Lord. It's in ours. You want to prove yourself faithful in our lives. So God, I just ask that everyone in here, Lord, as they lift their hearts in worship, that they would just trust you, that you are a faithful God, regardless of the uncertainty they see around them, that they would know that you are steadfast and faithful in their lives. It's in your son's name that we pray. Amen.